Hello, everyone.
Hello.
Is your Sabbath going all right?
Amen.
Faring well? That was beautiful worship, amen? And I want to say that Billy's music really ministered to me, yeah? Thank you, Billy and Elia, all of you, for using your talents for the upbuilding of the kingdom. It's a beautiful thing. All right, so Sabbath evening, 7 o'clock, we're going to talk sort of about the second part of what we began this morning. How many of you were with us this morning? Is that most of you? Maybe an easy way to do this. Put the hands down. How many were not with us this morning? All right, well, that's complicated. That's less than ideal. Where were you? What could you possibly have been doing? Welcome to Impact San Antonio. This is going to be my last presentation, and I want to thank all of the people that invited me to be here, that made it possible for me to be here. Benjamin and Marquise and Japheth and Gil and James and the others that I've forgotten. It's a privilege to be here. I'm really, really passionate about communicating the gospel to young people so that they'll be on fire for it. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
And I cannot tell you how much my heart warms within me. My spirit jumps within me when I hear people like Billy Otto singing Adventist songs. Can you, yeah, let's come on now. Just to be clear, that doesn't mean that I'm not favorable to a song written by a Baptist or an Evangelical or a Pentecostal. We do not have a copyright or a corner on the truth. And somebody say amen to that. Nothing wrong with that. Amen. I'm thrilled for the contributions that have been made to music and to hymnology down through time. And we are standing on the shoulders of giants, both ancient and modern, when it comes to music. However, I have felt for a long time that there should be a stronger encouragement within the Adventist community in the arts. Whether it's music or whether it's in painting or drawing or multimedia or graphic design, whatever it is, I believe that we have a unique perspective to offer in the arts, and that we do ourselves a disservice when all we do is recapitulate what others have done. Amen for what others have done, and amen for those songs and those paintings and those journals and whatever it might be, that, you know, even writing. But we have something to say. Do you believe that? And I believe that we don't just have something to say. I believe we have something very important to say. Hugely important. And yes, it should be wrapped in theology. And yes, it should be wrapped in preaching. We're really good at the preaching part. We're really good at the theology part. We're really good at the sort of didactic, intellectual, cerebral thing. But I feel like sometimes we have unwittingly cut a whole kind of group of people off from communicating the truth, who think in more artistic ways and who think in terms of music and colors and imagery and writing. And are you feeling this?
Yeah, yeah.
So my prayer, I tell you, when I see Adventist musicians and singers and songwriters, and I gotta say that I am thrilled that there is, I'm saying this by faith, there is, I believe, increasingly a groundswell of Adventist musicians, singers, and songwriters. I was just so thrilled to visit with Elia briefly backstage and have him say that he right now is working on writing some Adventist worship songs. Well, there's an idea. Can you say amen? Do we have a contribution to make? Yes, we do. Do we have a perspective? Yes, we do. Are there some uniquely and beautifully and idiosyncratically Adventist things that only we could say? Are there songs that only we could write? And the answer is yes. And so we're going to say amen to the songs written by our brothers and sisters in various faith communities. But I'm praying that there will be a groundswell of passion in the arts, because there's a whole lot of people that are just not going to sit and listen to a message like I will preach, but who would listen to a song, or who would read something, etc. Are we together, same page? So I want to thank you, Billy, and I want to thank the others. That beautiful group this morning, Juniper, the two from Maine, they can sing. That was beautiful. And I had a really nice connection this evening with Patrick, and he said they're going to be making some things available back there. So please, at every opportunity, even if you are tempted to say, well, that's not my style of music. Okay, do me a favor. If you are exposed to an Adventist singer-songwriter who's trying to use their talents for the upbuilding of the kingdom by doing something that is uniquely and artistically Adventist, I plead with you, support them.
Yes.
Can you say amen? I'm begging you, support them. Just support these people. And by the grace of God, we might create a whole nother space where it's not just about the preaching, and it's not just about the theology, and all of that informs the arts. But I would love for us to have this whole new way of doing ministry. And I just plead with you on behalf of them, and there are, and as I say, an increasing number of them, if you see people that are trying to do something in the arts, whether music or visual or writing, and you can support them, please do. Amen? Okay, that's nothing to do with the sermon. Actually, it does, only tangentially, but I just wanted to say that. All right, we're going to pray, and then we're going to get into our presentation here. Our continuation of what we began this morning. We were in Acts chapter what? Who remembers? This morning we were in Acts chapter 9, thank you. And this evening we're going to be mainly in Acts 13, 14, and 17. Or as the Aussies would say, 13, 14, and 17. All right, let's pray together. Father in heaven, it's a big day today. It's a big day today because we're alive. A whole lot of people went to sleep last night and didn't wake up today, Father. We're never going to see another day like this. There'll never be another day just like this one. And Father, there's still a little bit of this day left, so help us to capitalize on it. Help us to make the best of this day, because it's gone after it leaves us. Tomorrow we'll never see this day again. And so, Father, today help us to make the most of the present, of this gift. Maybe that's why they call it the present. Help us to make the best of this. Father, we know you are not just the God who is. Neither are you just the God who was. You said to Moses, I am. I'm right here in this moment. Father, forgive us. We spend so much time living in the past and looking to the future, but what about right now, this moment? And so, Father, help us now by the inspiration of your Spirit, under the unction of your Spirit, to hear your word to us. Father, I'm praying that this message will come across in a cogent and compelling and powerful way, but Father, the preacher can only do what the preacher can do. I'm praying that your Spirit would do what no man or woman could ever do. Come and change hearts. Come and change lives. Father, this morning we responded to Saul, and Brother Saul, and Ananias. And today, as we this evening take a little turn, as we talk about what that Ananias looks like, that ministry of reaching out and extending the hand of faith and fraternity and community. Father, this is a tricky one. And you know it's tricky. And Father, there's going to be a lot of lines around my preaching here that I could easily step over. I'm praying that I won't. Help me to stay on this side of your will, on this side of faithfulness. And Father, I pray there would be very little David Asscherick in this, as little as is possible, and a whole lot of Scripture and a whole lot of Jesus. So give me wisdom and be with us now as we turn our attention to you. In Jesus' name, let everyone say, amen. Let's go to Acts 13 together. Let's go there. This is going to be a Bible study. Is that okay? Okay, this is going to be a Bible study. We are in Acts chapter 13. I already spent about, maybe 10 or 15 minutes this morning sort of setting up where we are in the book of Acts. I'll just briefly say, the book of Acts was written by who? Written by Luke. It's divided roughly into two parts. The first third is largely Peterine. It's largely Jerusalem. It's the church. The second two-thirds, largely Pauline, outside of Jerusalem, and a transition away from the church and the 12 to the Gentile community. When I say the church, I mean the church in Jerusalem. There are these sort of fulcrum passages in Acts, beginning with about Acts chapter 7 and extending to Acts chapter 12. Before that, it's, you know, as we mentioned, largely Peter, the ministry of Peter, the exploits of Peter, the imprisonments of Peter, the preaching of Peter. Okay, then we go to this sort of fulcrum section here, where you have the preaching of Stephen, you have the experience of the preaching of Philip to the Ethiopian eunuch, then the conversion of Saul, which we spent time on, then the vision of Peter to Cornelius. All of this is setting up. Luke is masterfully, intentionally setting up where he's going, and that's that the gospel is going to people like the Ethiopian eunuch. The gospel is going to people like Cornelius. But he doesn't just run headlong into the exploits of Paul in the Gentile world. He has to set it up. So he spends time on Peter, then you have these fulcrum or transition passages from about chapter 7 to chapter 12, and then it tips over into the rest, the lion's share of the book of Acts, 13 to 28, are the missionary journeys of Paul. Three, if you count his fatal trip to Rome, four journeys, right? And that's basically the rest of the book of Acts. As we've already mentioned here, there can be little doubt that Luke was not only the biographer of Paul, Luke loved Paul. He revered Paul. We could say it in very simple language that Paul was Luke's hero. He was familiar with his theology. He went with him on his travels. He was an apologist for Paul, as we mentioned briefly. It's entirely possible that the Theophilus to whom Luke is writing in both the Gospel and also in Acts was something like the equivalent of Paul's defense attorney in Rome. Scholars and commentators have noted that one of the major themes in the book of Acts is the way that Paul is continually coming into contact with Roman society and especially Roman leadership and government. And in each case, Paul finds himself on the right side of the law, and the Romans are often coming to Paul's defense. Right? And so there's this sort of thread, this theme, and it's possible that Luke is writing to Theophilus as a sort of defense attorney, setting up the legitimacy and the law-abiding nature of this man that we know as the apostle. Be that as it may, right? Be that as it may, what we have beginning in Acts chapter 13 and extending down to the end is a story of the adventures of Paul. We're going to talk about one of those adventures. We're going to talk about several of them. We're in Acts chapter 13. First of all, they sail to Cyprus. We mentioned this briefly this morning, that Paul rebukes the sorcerer there. He gets access to a guy named Sergius Paulus, and the Bible says he was an intelligent man, and he comes to faith. They then make their way to the mainland, and they come to a place called Antioch. What's it called, everyone? Antioch. Antioch can be a little confusing in the book of Acts because there are two Antiochs, right? There was Antioch just north of Jerusalem, and then there was Antioch in Pisidia, or Syria, what we today would call Turkey. And so you can kind of lose track of it. Both of these cities, of course, are named after Antiochus, and, in modern times as well as in ancient times, cities were named after important people. This Antioch that we're in here is Antioch in Pisidia, or Syria. This is a long way, especially in those times, not so much by modern standards, a long way from Jerusalem. Paul is in the new worlds. He's out there bringing the gospel, as we mentioned this morning just briefly, that shortly after Paul's conversion, he was immediately preaching Christ. Right? There was no latency. There was no necessary hiatus. There was no requirement that he go, and sort of get his act together, though he certainly did spend a number of years in Arabia, though those years are not easily located in the book of Acts. But here in Luke 13, we find Paul. He's in Antioch. Let's see what happens. We're in verse 1. Or excuse me, we're in verse 13. Luke 13, or Acts 13, 13. Now when Paul and his party set sail from Paphos, they came to Perga in Pamphylia. And John, departing from them, returned to Jerusalem. But when they departed from Perga, they came to Antioch in Pisidia, and they went into where? Where did they go? They went into the synagogue. Now, we tend to think of synagogue as something like the equivalent of a church, but that would be an oversimplification. The synagogue was not only a religious place, it was also like a town hall, right? Weddings could happen there. Just basic, even what you might refer to as secular meetings, not that the Jews would have conceded the divide between the sacred and the secular, but it wasn't just a church. It wasn't just a religious place. They go into the synagogue. It was the appropriate place to go. Paul makes his way in there on the Sabbath day. So this is going to be an intentionally purpose-built religious service. Verse 15, they go and they sit down. This is the days before Twitter, the days before Instagram, the days before Facebook. So nobody knows who these guys are. Mm-hmm. Right? They're just travelers. And so they sit down. It's noticed that there are visitors among them, and so they are given the invitation. Hey, you're traveling. Where are you from? Oh, we come from a number of places. And they would have said, Paul, I'm from Tarsus, but I've been spending time in Jerusalem. Now, they could have been taught, okay, hey, do you have anything you'd like to say? Paul's like, I'll take you up on that. Verse 15, after the reading of the law and the prophets, the rulers of the synagogue sent to them and said, hey, men and brethren, if you have any word of exhortation for the people, say on. You're travelers, please, come, have something to say. So Paul is given the opportunity here. Verse 16, then Paul stood up and motioning with his hand, he said, and this is key. Paul's passion, and we're going to discover this again and again and again, Paul's passion is very much in keeping with Mark Finley, with what Mark Finley talked about last night in his excellent sermon. Paul's passion was winning souls. Paul's passion was preaching the gospel. So in whatever situation is, in whatever context, whether he's eating breakfast or standing in a synagogue, whatever Paul is doing, you can be certain that the idea of communicating the gospel of Jesus Christ was not far from the forefront of his mind. Right? So he's been given an opportunity to stand up, and Paul is about ready to go to work. Now, there are many places in the book of Acts where Luke records Paul as going into a synagogue. Many places. I think there are 14 or 13 times where it says Paul came to a certain town, he went into the synagogue. He came to a certain town, he went into the synagogue. Went into the synagogue. Went into the synagogue. Went into the synagogue. But the only place where Luke records what Paul said in that synagogue is in Acts 13. Luke appears to, he wants us to infer that the kind of thing that he said in Acts 13 is the kind of thing he said in all instances where he was invited into a synagogue to speak. Now, just a little brief parenthetical statement on this. I just came from the Lightbearers Convocation this year as part of our study through a book of the Bible. We studied through the book of Hebrews. Can the church say amen?
Amen.
It's an amazing New Testament book. And one of the things that we drew out in our 21-part treatment of the book of Hebrews, right through, chapter by chapter, verse by verse, is this. It's entirely possible, perhaps even likely, that Paul, as the author of Hebrews, if you believe that's the case, and I think there's good internal and external evidence for that, that the book of Hebrews might well be the sort of template for the things that Paul said when he would go into these synagogues. Right? When he would go to talk to his people, when he was among his folk and he was speaking their language, this is how he spoke. Be that as it may, there is a fascinating little thing. In the book of Hebrews, there are three towering Old Testament figures. Of course, the towering figure of the book of Hebrews is none other than Jesus Christ, the great high priest. Can somebody say amen? But if you as a Jew took in a sweep of your history, right? There would be lots of very important people, very important events, very important situations. But as a Jew, I'm asking you now, who do you think might have been the three towering figures of Judaism? The three figures without which Judaism doesn't make sense. There are lots of peaks in this mountain range, to use our analogy, but there are three towering peaks. There's that tall one, and that tall one, and that, and the others high, though high, are not as high as them. Who do you think one of those peaks might be?
Abraham,
of course. Of course, the story doesn't get started without Abraham, right? We can spend a lot of time on that. I'm going to resist the temptation. So you got Abraham. Who else might you have?
Moses.
Abraham, Moses, and the third one?
David.
Abraham, Moses, and David. The three towering peaks of the Old Testament. No wonder when Matthew opens up his gospel, the very first thing that he says is, Jesus Christ, the son of Abraham, the son of David. Right? When we're talking about Abraham and Moses and David, we are telling the Jewish story, we're telling the biblical story. And so unsurprisingly, the book of Hebrews, the very favorite book of the author of the book of Hebrews, the Old Testament book that he quotes, and again, I'm operating here under the assumption that Hebrews is very likely written by Paul and constituted more or less the kinds of things he would say when he went into these synagogues. His favorite book that he quotes from is the book of Psalms. The author of most of the Psalms would be David. The two major Old Testament figures that he then spends time discussing in the book of Hebrews are, guess who? David, because he's quoting from the Psalms. Who else? Abraham and Moses. Watch what happens here. He goes in, Jewish synagogue, Sabbath morning. Paul knows his audience. Paul, what did I say? Paul knows his audience. Look at this. He tells us, first words out of his mouth, I'm in verse 16 of Acts chapter 13, men of Israel. He knows to whom he is speaking, and let's just sort of go to the beginning of his sermon here. We're not going to read the whole thing through. Men of Israel, and you who fear God, listen. The God of this people, Israel, chose our fathers and exalted the people when they dwelt in strangers in the land of Egypt, and with an uplifted arm he brought them out of it. Now for a time of about 40 years he put up with their ways in the wilderness, and when he had destroyed seven nations in the land of Canaan, he distributed their land to them by allotment. After that he gave the judges for about 450 years until Samuel the prophet. And afterward they asked for a king, so God gave him Saul, the son of Kish, a man of the tribe of Benjamin. And when he had removed him, he raised up for them who? Who? David. Now clearly this is a story that Paul knows is hugely familiar to his audience. He's talking about Samuel, he's talking about Saul, he's talking about Israel, and he's talking about David. Paul knows his audience. He's in a Jewish setting on the Jewish day of worship in a synagogue speaking to Jews. So what does he talk about? He talks about Jewish history. So far, so good? He tells a Jewish story. He tells a Jewish story, which is what you would expect. Jump down to verse 26. Men and brethren, sons of the family of who? Abraham, and those among you who fear God, to you the word of this salvation has been sent. Verse 36, for David, after he had served his own generation. Verse 39, and by him everyone who believes is justified from all things which you could not be justified by the law of Moses. Unsurprisingly, the three figures that feature most strongly and most prominently in Luke's sort of mini recollection of Paul's sermon, certainly the sermon would have been much longer than what we have recorded here, but when Luke sets out to sort of tell us this is the kind of thing that Paul would say when he went into a synagogue, remember, this is the only place where we have the text of what he said. Time after time, into the synagogue, into the synagogue, into the synagogue, into the synagogue, into the synagogue. But this is the only place where we're told the kind of thing that he said. And unsurprisingly, the towering figure of Moses, the towering figure of Abraham, the towering figure of David, he's telling a Jewish story to Jewish people in a Jewish location with people who are familiar with the story. Are we together, everyone? Okay, so far so good. Paul then leaves there. There were some that believed. There were some that were stirred up to faith. Others were stirred up to hostility. Paul leaves Antioch. He comes to a place south and east of Antioch called Iconium. Verse 1. Chapter 14, verse 1. I told you this was going to be a Bible study. Get your phone out. Get whatever you need out and follow along. Now, what happened in Iconium that they went together to the where? Where do they go? Because that's Paul's MO. That's what you do. You go into a city that has a Jewish context, you're telling a Jewish story about a Jewish Messiah based on Jewish scriptures, and so you go to the Jewish place of meeting. It's just common sense, basic stuff. You're gonna go to where there are people that will be sympathetic to the story that you have to tell. So he goes into Iconium, he goes into the synagogue of the Jews, and he spoke to a great multitude, both of the Jews and of the Greeks that believed, but the unbelieving Jews stirred up the Gentiles and poisoned their minds against the brethren. Luke does not tell us what he says. He assumes that you as the reader, or in this case, Theophilus as the original reader, will know that there's some consistency between the kind of thing he just said in Antioch and the kind of thing he's going to say here. Jewish setting, Jewish story, Jewish scriptures, Jewish Messiah, men of Israel. Are we together, everyone? Okay, now something remarkable happens. He's chased out of Iconium. He goes virtually due south to the town of Lystra. Now watch this. This is where things get interesting. In Lystra, a certain man without strength in his feet was sitting crippled from his mother's womb and who had never walked. This man heard Paul speaking, and Paul, observing him intently, seeing that he had faith to be healed, he said with a loud voice, "Stand up straight on your feet," and he leaped and walked. Now I mentioned this just briefly this morning, I want to say it again. There can be no doubt that Luke is legitimizing the ministry of Paul. When Peter's ministry begins, he preaches with power, he rebukes a sorcerer, he wins a sympathetic Roman, and he heals a person of a serious infirmity, a disease, a paralyzed person. Okay. When Luke tells Paul's ministry, guess what he says? He preached with power, he rebuked a magician, he won a sympathetic Roman, the man of the island of Cyprus, just weeks before, and he heals a guy who was lame from his mother's womb. Peter's story, Paul's story. Luke is making a point. He's saying this guy's ministry is legit. Mm-hmm. Now why? Why? Why make the point? As we've already mentioned, Paul, because Paul, and this is going to come out tonight, Paul was over here on the fringes. A lot of people were uncomfortable with the ministry of Paul. I know the camera are going to hate this because I'm in the light, but that actually illustrates my point. Paul's over where he doesn't belong. Right, Paul's over where he's getting feedback. I like that. He's over there getting feedback. He's getting pushback from his community because the way that he carries himself in a Gentile situation, in a Gentile context, is deeply uncomfortable to many people who are of the Jewish faith because they have grown up with an antipathy, with a hatred, with a bipartisanship that is in their genes. And they become deeply uncomfortable when a Jew looks a little too comfortable, a little too savvy, a little too happy in and around Gentile situations, Gentile people, and Gentile context. But Paul, as we've already seen, when God revealed his vision for Paul's life to Ananias, he said, he's going to bear my name before the Gentiles. And so Paul is always out on the fringes of what's socially acceptable. He's a controversial figure. The simplest way to say it is that Paul is hugely controversial. In fact, a little parenthetical statement here. Paul's controversial nature is actually going to be the thing that eventually leads to his death and demise because the church is going to pull him in on the carpet. They're going to try to get him to do something that was politically correct. He went along with it. He was found, this is in Acts 21, he was found because he was encouraged to go along so it would look as though he hadn't forsaken the law of Moses or whatever. He's recognized, he's captured, he's imprisoned, and it leads ultimately to his death. It would not be an overstatement to say that the church's lack of comfort and lack of the scrutiny that they had in the ministry of Paul ultimately led to his death and demise prematurely. The church! The greatest missionary that ever lived, short of Jesus, was imperiled. His life was imperiled because the church was trying to save face with people. Because Paul was renegade. Paul was cavalier. Paul was radical. He's always out here on the fringes pushing the envelope. Paul knows his congregation. When he's in a Jewish setting, in a Jewish, telling a Jewish story, men of Israel. Luke is legitimizing his ministry. He's saying, Peter did, Paul did. Peter did, Paul did. Peter did, Paul did. Peter did, Paul did. Because Paul had a lot of enemies, and those enemies were not always Gentiles. In fact, often in the book of Acts, we find it was the religious leaders and sometimes the believers in Messiah Jesus that were Paul's greatest enemies from within his own community of faith. Controversial figure. Here we go. Verse 11. Now when the people saw what Paul had done, they raised their voices, saying in Lyconian language, "The gods have come down to us in the likeness of men." Not exactly the effect that Paul was hoping for. Barnabas they called Zeus, and Paul they called Hermes because he was the chief speaker. The very word for biblical interpretation that we use is the word hermeneutics. Hermeneutics actually finds its origin, its etymological origin, in Hermes. Listen, Hermes, hermeneutics. Hermes was the deliverer of divine messages and often the interpreter of those divine messages. And so when these two guys roll into town, there's one guy who's quiet, he's reserved, and the citizens of Lystra, they assume that Barnabas must be the guy who's really in charge because he's saying nothing, and Paul is his spokesperson. Well, there's Zeus, he doesn't say a word. And there's Hermes, he won't shut up. What they know is that a healing, a marvelous, miraculous healing has taken place. They are so impressed with the nature of this healing, it must have been marvelous, because they say, man, the gods have come down among us. This alerts us to the fact, hugely superstitious culture. Then the priest of Zeus, and this is one of those little serendipitous occurrences that occur several times in the book of Acts. It's just like, wow, what are the chances? Then the priest of Zeus, whose temple was in front of their city, brought oxen and garlands to the gates, intending to sacrifice it with the multitudes. In other words, as this act of healing is happening, has happened, and as they're referring to Paul and Barnabas as Zeus and Hermes, at that very moment, coincidentally, providentially, serendipitously, whatever you want to say, here comes a priest of Zeus with an ox all ready for the slaughter, and he's making his way to, hey, Zeus is here! Whoa. Right? So they sort of steer the convoy of worship over to, this healed man and Paul and Barnabas, who are just sitting there with utter incredulity, trying to take in what's happening. And Paul can say, oh no, he can see what's happening. When the apostles of Barnabas and Paul heard this, they tore their clothes and they ran out among the multitudes and said, "Men, why are you doing these things? We are also men with the same nature as you, and we preach that unless you turn from these useless things to the living God, who made the heaven and the earth and the sea and all the things that are in them, who in bygone generations allowed all nations to walk in their own ways, nevertheless he did not leave them without a witness, and that he did good, he gave us rain from the heavens and fruitful seasons, filling our hearts with food and gladness." And when he's done, it's so interesting what Luke says, and he has a flair for the humorous. He says, when he finished saying these things, they could scarcely restrain the multitudes from sacrificing to them. Paul goes in to try to stop this, you know, blasphemous thing, and they're like, whoa, the humility of the gods. The elocution of the gods. Get that ox over here. Come on, we got to sacrifice. And Paul is tearing his clothes, but here's the point. In amidst this cacophonous, wild, zany, let's be honest, it's a zany story. Did you pick up what it was that Paul said to these people? Let me just remind you a few things. First of all, they're not in the synagogue. This is not a Jewish audience, clearly, ready to sacrifice to Zeus. Not a Jewish setting, not the Sabbath morning, not people who are not familiar with the towering figures of Abraham, Moses, and David. No, 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 no. So how does Paul speak to these people? What are the points of contact? What are the points of commonality? Not a word about Israel. Not a word about David, not a word about Moses, not a word about Abraham, none of it. And why pray tell not? That's the truth. Is Paul afraid to preach the truth? No, 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 no. Paul knows his audience. Say it with me. Paul knows his audience. I need a little more enthusiasm than that. Paul knows his audience. So what then does he say? What does he say? Okay, let's go through it. We also are men with the same nature as you. That's bridge building. I'm like you. How often does our witnessing begin with, hey, you're not like me?
Mercy!
You see where he starts? Hey, I'm like you, men with the same nature as you. Watch, it gets better. We preach to you that you should turn from these useless things to the living God. Who is the living God? Is it not Zeus and his messenger Hermes? No, no, good guess. Who made the heaven, the earth, the sea, and all the things that are in them. What's he talking about when he talks about the made, the heaven, the earth, the sea, and all of them? What's the point of contact? Creation. Creation. Paul didn't talk about creation in the synagogue. There was no need. There was commonality. It's understood. But here, I got bridges to build, and I got to build them now because these people are about ready to sacrifice an ox to me. So you start where every culture has some basic theology or tale or myth or story about where we came from. And so Paul starts at the most basic point of contact and commonality he can. Wow. The Creator God.
Yes, yes.
I'm just going to say it again, even though it's so obvious, it barely needs mentioning. Nothing about Moses, nothing about Genesis. You hearing me? Nothing about David, nothing about Israel, nothing about Abraham. He talks about the Creator God. Who is this Creator God? Verse 16, who in bygone generations allowed all nations to walk in their own ways. Nevertheless, he did not leave himself without a witness. Well, who is he then? How would we know who he is? Where is this witness that he has left? I'm going to tell you now about Moses. No, he didn't talk about Moses. What is this witness that he has left? He has done good. So he's a good God, which is inferable from the fact that he's a creator. He's under no compulsion to create. He creates because he's good. What does he do to demonstrate his goodness? He gave us the books of Moses. I'm going to keep pressing that point. What did he do? He gave us rain.
Mercy.
Oh, funnily enough, it rained in Lystra. It rained in Lystra. So the point of contact at the most basic level is God is a creator, I am a person like you, and I have a message from the God who sends the rain.
Yes.
Okay. What else has he done? He gives us fruitful seasons. The God who sends the sun, who sends the fruit, who sends bounty. This is the God I'm describing. Who are you talking about? The God who fills our bellies and hearts with food and joy. Do you see what's going on here? He is building the most basic, you know, Sabbath school, grade 3, grade 4 level of connectivity with the people who aren't from his culture, who aren't from his context, who aren't from his situation. He doesn't start at the PhD level with the history of Israel, and he doesn't even go there. He's like, I have a message. It's from the big guy upstairs who sends the rain. The one that makes you happy, gives you an apple. We love apples, don't we? I mean, Paul knows his audience. Paul knows who he's talking to. When he speaks to people who do not understand his context, he doesn't assume that they will understand the context, and he doesn't start there. He starts where he has to lead them, sometimes circuitously, but as quickly as possible, to Jesus.
Yes, yes, yes.
Now here's the remarkable thing. Jesus is the God of Israel. And I'm going to say something here that might not sit with some of you. Jesus is the God of the world.
Yes.
Jesus is the God of Israel, but Jesus is the one true God of the world. And there have actually been people from all cultures, in all times, in all circumstances, and even at times, and I know this might get a little, I might be out on the edges with Paul here, even from every religious system, to some degree, I'll give that a qualifier, from virtually every religious system, who have unknowingly been worshiping the one true God. So why would you show up and immediately start tearing down the culture and tearing down what they believe? No, no, no. Paul wants to find those places of contact. He wants to find those places of connectivity. And when he has located them, he starts to build bridges to Jesus. Yeah. Rather than saying, oh, well, this will never do. We got to clean the slate. Start over. No, 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 no. Where are the points of contact? Where are the points of commonality? Where are the points where your culture intersects God's culture? Where are the places where your culture intersects? I don't have to tear you down to build up Jesus. I don't have to tear your culture down to build up Jesus. I need to find the points of contact and of commonality. Now clearly Paul is not a compromiser here. He's not a compromiser because he is saying these idols are useless things and don't offer sacrifices to me. Paul is not compromising the truth in the name of contextualization, but neither is he elevating some contextual language or nomenclature that effectively excludes people from coming to the Messiah that he wants to bring them to. And we do this all the time in our churches. Oh, wouldn't it be something if somebody could walk into any Seventh-day Adventist church on any Sabbath morning and find Jesus?
Yes.
The Jesus that we see in the New Testament is accessible.
Yes.
People come to him. Lepers come to him. Gentiles even come to him. Little children come to him. We practice in my little church that I have the privilege of pastoring in Australia. We practice a very simple philosophical idea on Sabbath morning. We call it a safe Sabbath. Every Sabbath is a safe Sabbath. Now that doesn't mean that we don't say anything that might be hard for people to hear. That's not what we mean by safety. What we mean by safety is we don't assume that people know our language or know our culture or know all of the Adventist stuff that we know really well. So we take our language and we make it as accessible as possible for people who are coming. We don't do church with Seventh-day Adventists in mind. We do church with sinners and seekers in mind. Because if you do church for sinners and seekers, the Adventists will also be blessed. But if you do church for Adventists, the sinners and the seekers are sitting there going, what are they talking about? Oh, brothers and sisters, today after the Sabbath service, happy Sabbath. We're going to have a potluck, and we're also going to be having a Bible study group. We'll be looking through the first volume of the Conflict of the Ages series. The upcoming general conference session is taking place. We'll be appointing a new general conference president. We want to pray for that. And so you're all invited. Maranatha. With a guy guy before I came here. Before I came here, my last pastoral visit was with a man who, his name is Taki. And Taki came to my church for the very first time. He'd ever been to any church ever. Ever! And he came and I was like, Taki, what do you think of church? A little weird, a little wild, a little strange. He's like, no, I liked it. And I was just like, thank you, Jesus, that somebody that doesn't know anything. We don't assume familiarity with our language. We don't assume familiarity with our culture. We don't assume familiarity with our governmental system. You know, there's the old story about, you know, a new convert that went to an Adventist prayer meeting, and the dear sister, you know, they were praying, and the new convert's there, and she's, you know, in the prayer, and somebody's praying, and says, God in heaven, please be with the union. And she's like, yes, be with the union. And then the prayer continued on, and a little bit later she said, and God, please be with the division. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Let me tell you this. Your church is conducting 52 evangelistic meetings every year, whether you know it or not. And most of them are hugely unsuccessful.
Come on.
Do you not open your doors? Do you not say all are welcome? That's an evangelistic meeting. That's a meeting where you are communicating a message. Now my question is, are you doing it with intentionality? Or is your service and your music and your culture and everything geared around people who are already in the know? If that's true, then don't be surprised that you're not getting visitors. Why wouldn't they come? We communicate that it's not for them.
Come on.
Especially when we say things like, you know, just this week I was out knocking on doors, looking for contacts, and I met the loveliest non-Adventist couple. The loveliest what? I met the loveliest non-white couple. Oh, they weren't white, they were lovely. Non-white, non-black, non-Baptist. Why do we feel this strange compulsion to break the whole world up into two basic groups? People like us and everybody else. If I could uninvent the word non-Adventist, I would uninvent it, because it creates a linguistic barrier, and if time allowed, I could show you how passionate I am about that, the dangerous steps that we take when we allow language to... Language carries ideas, and when we're not careful about language, we lose ideas. And when we allow the language of non-Adventist to be a smooth, easy part of our day-to-day vocabulary, we are unwittingly building up a mental, psychological, spiritual, and evangelistic barrier against them. And it is not unlike the Jewish-Gentile distinction.
You are on.
Are we together? Now, why would Paul be so passionate about this? Why isn't Paul just happy to tell a Jewish story? Well, I'm going to go out on a limb and say here that Paul is following in the footsteps of his Savior Jesus.
Yes.
Now, let me give you the quick version here. Quick version. Jesus is walking on the shore of a lake, and he sees fishermen. Ideas. How do I appeal to these people? How do I speak their language? What does Scripture say? Hey, Peter. Hey, James. Hey, John. Follow me. I'll make you what? Okay, so Jesus is speaking to a guy whose name we don't know. He's just called the rich young ruler. We'll call him Rich. He was a businessman. He was an entrepreneur. So when Jesus is speaking to a businessman who's entrepreneurially minded, he doesn't say, hey, Rich, follow me and I'll make you a fisher of men. No, I'm good. Never been fishing. They're all slimy, icky, gross. What does he say? Follow me and you will have treasures in heaven. Speak in the language now. When Jesus meets a woman at the well, he doesn't say, follow me, I will make you a fisher of men. What does he say to her? He that believes in me will never thirst. You come every day. You come every day to this well, and you sit at this well, and you need water. I want to talk to you about water. In John chapter 8, there's this fascinating, lengthy dialogue where Jesus is having one of the most hostile and confrontational encounters with the religious leaders of his day, the Pharisees, and they want to talk about dads and Abraham. And Jesus is like, you want to talk about dads and Abraham? You are of your father, the devil. You want to talk about Abraham? Before Abraham was, I am. Okay, so in other words, who's Jesus talking to? Is he talking to shepherds? I'm going to talk about sheep. Is he talking to people who are getting ready to get married? I'm going to talk about a wedding. Is he talking in an agrarian culture? The grain of the kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed. To whom is Jesus speaking? Is Jesus speaking to lost people? What story does he tell? He tells the story of a lost sheep and a lost coin and a lost, help me out here, a lost son. That's one of the most remarkable little series in all the writings of Luke, by the way. You should study that. Luke 15 and 16, because it says that Jesus turned his attention to the sinners and he told three parables about the lost. It says then he turned his attention to the disciples and he told the first of two most difficult parables that Jesus ever told. And the first was the parable of the guy that was unjust and unfaithful, a steward. Why does he tell a story about an unfaithful steward to his disciples? Oh, wait, they're the stewards.
That's right.
He then turns his attention, this is in the Gospel of Luke, it says, then he turned his attention to the Pharisees, and he tells a story about a self-satisfied, healthy, wealthy Jewish man. Why would he tell a story about a self-satisfied, healthy, wealthy Jewish man to a bunch of self-satisfied, healthy, wealthy Jewish men? To whom is Jesus speaking? You see, this is not some invention of Paul, some radical, you know, notion of contextualization. Paul, like Jesus, woke up in the morning, and when he breathed that first breath, it wasn't food that was on his mind. It wasn't Instagram that was on his mind. It wasn't computers that was on his mind. What was on his mind was bringing the gospel to people, introducing them to their Creator. He saw that in the ministry of Jesus, and so Paul unsurprisingly replicates it. Let me just read to you. If you want to join me, I'll come back to Acts 17. We'll land there. But let me just show you two passages of Scripture, both in the Corinthians. You can join me if you'd like. The first one is in 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 9. I'm just going to read this to you here toward the end. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, beginning in verse 19. 1 Corinthians 9, 19. Paul, following in the methodological footsteps of Jesus. Paul, following in the contextual footsteps of Jesus, what does he say? Verse 19, 1 Corinthians 9, for though I am free from all men, I have made myself a servant to everyone that I might win the more. I am under no obligation to any culture, to any people, to any circumstance, to any situation. Paul was saying, I'm a free man, but I willingly enslave myself to certain people's situations, to their circumstances, to their situations. Why? So that I can win them. I speak their language. I speak their culture. I want to engage these people for the purpose of bringing them to Jesus. How so? Verse 20, to the Jews, I became as a Jew, that I might win the Jews. And to those that were under the law, as under the law, that I might win those who were under the law. To those that are without the law, as without the law, not being without the law toward God, but under the law toward Christ, that I might win those who were without the law. To the weak, I became as weak, that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. And I do this for the gospel's sake.
Yes.
I want you to hear this. Nobody would voluntarily put themselves into slavery. But Paul feels this compulsion to place himself in a position of servitude and in a position of even inferiority in certain cultural contexts just so he can get their ear. Because he knows if he can get their ear and he can be filled with the Holy Spirit, he can build a bridge. And when he starts building those bridges, man, amazing things happen. Gentiles are converted, and kings and others have the gospel given to them. Paul finds himself in the very palace of Rome. How do you suppose he spoke there? I don't know. We don't have that record. But you can be certain it would have been appropriate for the occasion because Paul knows his audience.
Yeah.
We together?
Yeah.
2 Corinthians, this is a fascinating one. You're in 1 Corinthians 9, 2 Corinthians chapter 4. This is one of Paul's most profound summary statements of the gospel. Verse 6, For it is the God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness. That's Genesis 1. In the beginning, God said, let there be light. 2 Corinthians 4:6. Who has shone into our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus. We have this treasure in jars of clay so that the excellence may be of God and not of us. Now, scholars have noted a very fascinating little point here, and I want to try and draw it to your, bring it to your attention. Paul was a man of three worlds. Paul was a Roman citizen. Paul was raised in a Greek context, culture, and city. And Paul was a Jew. If you took those three cultures, if you took the Roman culture and the Jewish culture and the Greek culture, and you distilled them down to their basic essence, what might you have? In the case of Rome, all roads lead to Rome, and Rome wasn't built in a day. And when in Rome, do as the Romans. If you were going to take the whole edifice of Roman society and distill it down to a basic concept, a basic idea, a syllable around which all of Rome could be summarized, it would be glory. The glory of Rome, the grandeur of Rome, the prestige of Rome. She sits as a queen atop the nations. Glory. If you were to do the same for the Greek culture, the academy and the university, Plato, Socrates, Aristotle, and others, and you distill down the essence, the substance, to a single syllable, a single ideal, a single concept of what it means to be a Greek, it would be knowledge. And if you were to take the whole edifice of Hebrew culture, what's it about? In the beginning, God said, let there be light, and there was light. The light walked with them as the pillar of cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night. Thy word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Arise, shine, for thy light is come. The Old Testament is saturated again and again and again with this notion, with this idea that it boils down to light. It boils down to bringing God to the world. And so look at what Paul does here. Look at verse 6. He takes these three ideas and he synthesizes them. He takes the Roman idea of glory. He takes the Greek idea of knowledge. And he takes the Jewish idea of light. And he says, the God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, the Genesis God, the Creator God, the in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth God, in the beginning, the God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness has shown where? In our hearts. To what end? To give us the light, Hebrew culture, of the knowledge. The light of the glory of the knowledge. What I'm getting it wrong here. To give us the light, Jewish culture, of the glory of the knowledge, Greek culture, of the glory of God, Roman culture, in the face of Jesus. Paul synthesizes. He knows he's a man of three worlds, and he says, the height of the Roman culture, the thing to which Rome aspires, is found in Jesus. The thing, the logos, the Greek idea of knowledge, the grand truth to which Greek culture aspires is Jesus. The grand and beautiful thing that the Jewish Old Testament culture aspired to is Jesus. You see, for Paul, it's always about building bridges. It's always about giving people access. In fact, you could distill the Bible down, the whole Bible, to a single word. If you said to me, what's one word? You could make a case for many words. Maybe the word love, maybe the word freedom. But at the end of the day, for me, I would say the Bible boils down to the word access. Access is lost in Eden. It's restored in Eden. And everything from the sanctuary to Jesus is about access. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things are made by Him. Without Him was nothing made that was made. And then it goes down there at the beginning of John's Gospel, and it says, and the Word became flesh. The Word spoke the language of the people. He was accessible. He was the temple. Jesus is the master contextualizer. He became a man. To what end? To speak your language.
Yeah. Wow.
To walk a mile in your moccasins. Wow. To know what it is to live and breathe under the oppressive weight of the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life. Paul is simply following methodologically in the footsteps of Jesus, who said to fishermen, I'll make you a fisher of men, who said to thirsty women, I'll give you water, and who said to entrepreneurially minded young men, I'll give you treasures in heaven. Return with me briefly to Acts 17. Acts 17 is without question the pinnacle of Paul's radical contextualization. And the more that I look at this passage, the more I study it, the more remarkable it becomes. Paul has found himself in his peripatetic travels in Athens. Athens and Jerusalem, Athens and Israel are coming face to face here. And what was the old statement there? What has Athens to do with Jerusalem? Well, in Paul's response, quite a lot, actually. Let's see where this goes. Verse 16, while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was provoked within him, and he saw the city was given over to idols. He therefore reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews and with the Gentile worshippers, and in the marketplace daily with those who happened to be there. Here's Paul. He's a man in the marketplace. Yes, he's a man with the Gentiles. Yes, he's a man in the Jewish context. Yes, and in each one of those circumstances, you can be certain that Paul would have tailored his message to meet the needs of the audience to whom he was speaking. Why? To bring them to Jesus. So Paul finally gets his audience, and what's he going to say to these uncircumcised pagans? What's he going to say to these people who are worshiping sticks and stones and wood? And what's he going to say to these people? He is going to trash them. No, he's not. He's going to build bridge after bridge after bridge after bridge to these people. Let's see how he does it. Verse 22, Paul stood in the midst of the Areopagus and he said, men of Athens, not men of Israel. Men of what? Men of Athens. Paul knows to whom he is speaking. Men of Athens, number one. What else does he say? Men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are very religious. You are a religious people, and I perceive that you are religious. Number one, he knows his audience. Number two, you are religious. I affirm your basic religiosity. Number three, for as I was passing through and considering the objects of your worship, I was thinking about the things that you worship. Here he affirms that they were worshipers. I spent some time considering your culture, considering your city. I walked around, I tried to learn a little bit about who you are, rather than just coming in as a bull in a china shop saying, away with that, and none of that, and let me tell you about Abraham, let me tell you about Moses, let me tell you about David. And they would have been like, who is this babbler? They're going to say that anyway, but that's not going to come until the end, not at the beginning. See, sometimes people tune us out as babblers, we never even get anything to say. I was walking through your city and perceiving your basic religiosity, and I came upon an altar with the inscription, to the unknown God. Now this is testy. I'll tell you right now, if Paul lived in today, if Paul was a Seventh-day Adventist man, this guy would be one, he would be the singularly most controversial figure in the Seventh-day Adventist church. I assure you of that. Because he's about ready to say, in a pagan context, look at this, the rest of verse 23. The one whom you worship and you don't know it, I've got a message for you from this unknown God. You know the one you got the idol to out there? Did he just do that? Did he just build a bridge that was so strong and so rich that he literally just feel comfortable saying to them, I have a message for you from one of your own gods that you are worshiping? Mm-hmm. I think he did. I think he said that. Where does he start? Verse 24. God who made the world and everything in it. Unsurprisingly, he begins exactly where he began back in Lystra, with the Creator. That's where we need to start. Oh man, I've just gone too long already, but I'll tell you this. Every single thing that we have to say boils down to Genesis 1, 2, and 3. Everything that we have to say boils down to Genesis 1, 2, and 3. As Richard Davidson said, the whole Bible is summarized in Genesis 1, 2, and 3, and the rest of Scripture is a commentary on the first three chapters of Scripture. So if we get creation right, we get sexuality right. If we get creation right, we get family right. If we get creation right, we get diet right. If we get creation right, we get the environment right. If we get creation right, we get it right. So Paul starts at a point of basic commonality with all cultures. God who made the world and everything in it, since he is Lord of heaven and earth, he doesn't dwell in temples made with hands. He's transcendent. The Greeks would have known that. They just come out of their radical anthropomorphic mythologization. They would have resonated with that. Verse 25, nor is he worshipped with men's hands as though he needed anything, since he gives to all life and breath and all things. He is the giver of breath, including, but not limited to, Athenian philosophers. The breath that you just breathed right there, and the one you're breathing right now, and that breath as well, and that breath, he's building commonality. My God, our God, our God?
That's right.
the God that you worship unknowingly. He's given to breath all things. He has made from one blood, there's commonality. Very same thing he did in Lystra. I'm a man like you. I'm a man with the same nature as you. He has made from one blood every nation. He relates to them on the basic humanistic level of the commonality. We all put our pants on one leg at a time. Of course, they all wore dresses back then. We all put our dresses on. You know? We put them on, I guess, two legs at a time. I've never put on a dress. We have a basic commonality. That did not go the way I thought it was going to go. You heard what I was saying, though, didn't you? I'm almost done here, so just hang in here for the last couple minutes. He has made from one blood every nation of men dwell on the face of all the earth. He has determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their dwellings. My God is the God who rules over Athens. He's not only the God of Jerusalem, he's the God of Athens. He gives you breath. He is not bound by these temples that you have constructed, the Parthenon or any other such. Verse 27. Why? So that they should seek the Lord in the hope that they might grope for him and find him, though he is not far from each of us, not you. Mm-hmm. How often do we do this? Because we have our act together. Mm. Up here with us, we have our act together, and you, in our condescending way, well, let me come down and just teach you a little something about all this stuff we know. I'm just going to come down here and teach you a little something. No. Us. This is not an artificial identification. Paul saw himself in every person he met. Did you hear what I just said? This was not an artificial identification with the Athenian philosophers. Paul saw himself. He was a citizen of the world. I read one time, I think it was C.S. Lewis in one of his books, he said, if you're a citizen of the world, you can never be in exile. The world is your home because God the Father is the creator of the world. He says grope. What a funny word. The only thing you could ever grope for would be something that would be easily found. If I put you in a room and I said, there is a small diamond in this room, find it. You'd be like, and I blindfolded you. You'd be like, how? You'd be groping. But if I said, there's an elephant in this room, find it. Got him. These guys right here, I got him. If you can grope for something, it's easily found. Paul says, if you grope, you'll find it because he's right there. He's not distant. He's not building this chasm between, you've got so far to go. You would need to get 28 Bible studies before you could even, I'm sorry. You are so far over there. We're over here. Come over here. The truth is over here. I've come a little ways. I'm not comfortable leaving completely, but I'm, hey! No. Paul doesn't see this fundamental dissimilarity between him and the world that he's in. He sees a fundamental similarity. Is he with the Jew? He's a Jew. Is he with those who's under the law? He's under the law. Who's he with? He sees himself, as we would say in modern parlance, incarnationally, just like Jesus, who came down to dwell amongst the people. Paul said, well, if it was good enough for Jesus, it's good enough for me. Let me talk to you Athenian philosophers about the God that you worship, the creator God you don't even know, and he's right next to you. If you grow for him, you will find him. Verse 28, for we in him we live, we live and move and have our being, as also some of your own poets have said. Is he really going to do that? Is he going to quote from what? As some of, we are his offspring. Paul is now quoting from a pagan poet and having the temerity to say that pagan poet was saying something that was true. Beloved, I want to tell you this. All truth is God's truth. It doesn't matter who says it. All truth belongs to God. If an Adventist preacher says it and it's true, it's true. If a pagan says it and it's true, it's true. If a homosexual says it and it's true, it's true. If a Baptist says it, it's true. If a Muslim says it, it doesn't matter. All truth is God's truth and all beauty is God's beauty. As some of your own poets have said, here he shows a basic familiarity with their context and situation. We are his offspring. Therefore, since we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the divine nature is like gold or silver or stone or something that could be shaped to art and man's devising. Truly, in these times of ignorance, God overlooked, but now he commands all men everywhere, including Paul would have said myself, to repent, because he has appointed a day on the which he will judge the world in righteousness with justice by this man. Here he introduces Jesus. But notice Jesus comes at the end of the story. A man, and he begins to talk about the resurrection, and the Athenian philosophers can't bear it because it's just too anthropomorphic form. That's not the point. Paul has limited success in Athens. Of course he was going to have limited success. It was going to be a tough gig no matter what he did. But rather than coming in and just in Rambo style, Arnold Schwarzenegger Terminator style, laying waste to their culture, laying waste to their context, laying waste to their poets, laying waste to their idols, laying waste to their language, he says, is there anything redeemable here? And lo and behold, he finds some redeemable things. That doesn't mean that everything is redeemable. It just means that he found the redeemable things, and then he connected them to his own larger, beautiful, not just the Jewish culture. Yes, Jesus is a Jewish Messiah based on a Jewish text that's the fulfillment of a Jewish history, but Jesus is the God of the world. One of my spiritual heroes is a man named Roger Williams, and I'll close on this. Roger Williams was an American reformer. He was the founder of Rhode Island. He was the one that initially coined the phrase the separation of church and state. He was an American. Right? Before there was like America as we know it, he was an American. He understood the basic idea of religious liberty and religious freedom. He was way, way, way ahead of his time. Ellen White tells a little bit about his story in the book, The Great Controversy. He was fleeing in a storm. And in a storm, he was actually fleeing from a colony that was persecuting him because they wanted to insist on religion being done in a certain way and being enforced by the civil magistrate, and he couldn't bear it. He said, no, we can't do that. This whole idea of the separation of church and state traces in no small degree back, at least in terms of the American legacy, back to this man named Roger Williams. And so he was fleeing his own people, and he was going to live with the Native Americans. Now here's a remarkable thing about Roger Williams. He spoke 7 native languages. He was a friend of the natives, and when he was persecuted by his own, he went and lived among the natives. And he brought many of these natives, listen to me right now, you listen very carefully. He brought many of these natives to faith in Jesus. And you know what? There was a period in his life, you check this out, where he refused to baptize the Indians. But not for the reason that you might think. He wouldn't baptize them because he said, the church is not worthy of you. Into what would I baptize you? You are more Christian than the Christians. See, he learned the language. He lived with them. He spent time. I'm telling you, you need to read about this man. He was a giant, a spiritual giant, and he was walking in the footsteps of Jesus. He was walking in the footsteps of Paul. He was becoming all things to all people so that by all means he might save some. My appeal to you is this. At the end of the day, we can do this the hard way or the easy way. The hard way involves a lot of frustration, difficulty, and very little success, and you die. Right? That's the hard way. The hard way is you are not the generation that sees the return of Jesus. There have been a lot of generations that have gone before you, and that's one way we could do this. We could insist on remaining in our little Adventist citadel, in our little Adventist quarantine, and we're going to stay over here, and we're going to talk only our language, mainly to our own people, and we're going to stay in our own culture, our own context, our own situation, comfortable with our own, that we can stay there, and we can invite, and people will come. I can't. There will be people that will do it. It'll occasionally happen. People will cross that great cultural chasm and come in to this strange, idiosyncratic thing known as Seventh-day Adventist culture. It happens. Anybody here as a first-generation Seventh-day Adventist? See, you made the journey. You intrepid voyagers, good for you, you made the journey. But what if the church began to not so insist that our culture is the biblical culture? What if our message is the biblical message, but our culture just happens to be the way that we do it? What if we've not been called to make Seventh-day Adventists of people? What if we've just been called to preach the Seventh-day Adventist message? And then let that look like what it looks like wherever it lands. What if we've been called to just cast our seed upon the earth and see what happens? What if the Islamic people want to hear this message and continue to wear the hijab? Is there any text that says you can't? Wear away. What if they want to worship in a building that has an architecture that looks like a mosque? Go ahead. We're under no compulsion to put people in buildings with steeples and sitting on pews and listening to organ music. That has no part of Scripture.
Come on.
We have been called to preach Christ. We have been called to preach Christ in the context of the three angels' messages. Yes. This message is too important to be wrapped in the cultural cocoon of Seventh-day Adventists.
Yes. Yes.
This message is a word that the world needs to hear. And I want to challenge you. I don't know you, but you have a skin. You have a voice. You have a place. You have a niche. Wherever you are and whoever you are, preach Christ. Build those bridges. Speak to those people. Yeah. Find the redeemable things in your university, in your social circle, in your context. Mm. Find those things. Not everything is going to be redeemable. There are going to be some things that you're going to either have to discard or completely ignore. But you don't have to launch into a diatribe against them. Let that come when it comes. There'll be time enough for controversy. Find the redeemable things and connect and communicate and build and so be like your Lord and so be like Paul. Yeah. I don't know who you are, I don't know where you are, but I know you have a place, I know you have a space, and you're gonna build something. Mm. Yeah. You're gonna build something. And it's not just about turning people into versions of you. Mm. It's about letting people be who they are. For freedom, Christ has set us free, and we're gonna build. We're gonna build. Can we switch this up to Cornerstone? Would that be too, could we do that? Could we go there? We're going there. We're gonna build on the cornerstone, and the cornerstone is Christ. My appeal to you, take this message, this beautiful gospel, giant message for the world, and make it your own. Don't be intellectually lazy. Don't figure out what the message is, and then you take it in your language, in your culture, in your context, in your situation, and you tell not the world in some ambiguous, nebulous sense, you tell your world. Mm-hmm. Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
How many people are resonant with what we're talking about here? Yeah. Are you smelling what I'm cooking? Yeah. Raise your hands. You smelling this? Beloved, I plead with you. I plead with you. If we're going to make a mistake, if we're going to make a mistake, let's make a mistake on the side of mercy.
Yes.
Rather than remaining in our cultural cocoon, we get out there. We might make a few mistakes. We might stumble and say, oh, maybe that wasn't the wisest. Mm. But at this point, we are so far inside of ourselves, we're not even in danger of making mistakes.
Mm.
You feeling me? Mm. Stand to your feet and sing with me. Stand to your feet and sing.
The words to this song are from an old hymn. I hope the words are familiar. Let's sing together. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. My hope is built on nothing but Jesus' blood and Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest friend. I dare not trust the sweetest friend. Those words again. My hope is built.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness.
I dare not trust the sweetest frame.
I dare not trust the sweetest frame.
But only trust. may I live.
Oh, may I live in Him.
Dressed in His righteousness alone.
Amen.
Dressed in His righteousness alone.
Faultless I'll stand.
Faultless I'll stand before the Lord.
Seated in Christ alone.
Father, the storm has come to this world, and there are tectonic shifts that are taking place even now within culture. This thing is setting up, Father, for a grand storm, and we're going to find ourselves in uncomfortable scrutiny in the days ahead. Father, we don't know if that's 5 years or 50 years, but we know that this is a storm that will end with a fury and a power that should cause us to tremble, and we do tremble, but we don't tremble before the storm, we tremble before You. Father in heaven, there are other people caught in this storm. People that need to hear the message of a crucified and soon coming Savior. People that need to hear the great truth that no one comes to the Father except by Christ. And Father, I want to ask Your personal forgiveness where I, David Asscherick, have obfuscated that otherwise simple message and made it unnecessarily complicated. And then, Father, I ask Your forgiveness on behalf of our church where we have unnecessarily and tragically obfuscated the way, the truth, and the life. We've wrapped it in our language. We've wrapped it in our nomenclature. We've wrapped it in our culture. We've wrapped it in our institutions. Father, we have become a salt lick that is tucked away safely in some little box, and a box is then hidden in another box that's then tucked into a room that's locked in a house that nobody gets access to. Father, there are people in this room that go to universities. There are people in this room that have jobs. There are people in this room that have colleagues. Father, teach them, teach me, teach us how to take this message and have it not just be something that we do on Saturday morning, but something that becomes saturative in our lives. And we begin to see points of connectivity, points of commonality, points of community with those that are not us. And Father, maybe even disabuse our minds of this whole idea of us and them. Maybe there's only an us. Maybe there only ever was an us. Sinners standing equally condemned and yet equally saved and brought close by the blood of Jesus. Father, we avail ourselves today by faith of that blood. We believe in Your belief. We have confidence in Your confidence, and we have faith in Your faith. But Father, there are a whole lot of people out there that need to hear this message. We're going to need to learn. I don't have all the answers, Father. You know that. I don't even have the beginnings of the answers. But Father, at least if we have an awareness, we can start asking the right questions, and then we'll start figuring out the right answers. But Father, forgive us when we have waited for people to come to us. Sitting in our lazy boys in Jerusalem waiting for the Gentiles to show up. Father, forgive us. Do we have a message for the world or not? Father, I pray for the artists. I pray for the entrepreneurs. I pray for the marketers. I pray for the computer programmers. I pray for the doctors. Lord, you know we have our share of doctors. I pray for the scientists. I pray for the teachers. I pray for the nurses. I pray above all, perhaps, for the pastors. Father, I pray for our people, that we will go to our communities, into our contexts, into our cultures, and that we will bring the message of Christ. Fill us with your Spirit. Do what we could never do, is our prayer in the name of Jesus. Let everyone say, amen.